this little corner here, just what the doctor ordered. So I'm out on a bike ride, and this is where my favourite pee stops. So we're stopping for a pee. That's better. Oh, best things in life are free. I'm sure if the government could, they'd tax that. Anyway, I want to show you my bike and I want to tell you something. This is about the apocalypse bike and the 15-minute city. I don't know if any of you are subscribed to Neil Oliver. I really like Neil Oliver's channel. In fact, I like Neil Oliver as a person. I used to watch Time Team and other archaeological programs, and he was on some of those programs, and he recently done one about the 15-minute city, and I felt compelled to leave him a comment. Anyway, I'll read you my comment that I left. I have to get somewhere quieter. The road, it's not a busy road, it's a B road, B4000 I think it's called, but every now and again a car comes along and interrupts me. So let's find somewhere a bit quieter, and I'll read you my comment that I left him. This video is also about this village, the village of Swindon. This is one of the villages that I grew up in. I spent from the age of 11 to the age of 25 living in this village. And there's another village, about 2 miles, smaller village, about a mile over that way. And I lived in that one from the age of being born to the age of 11. So this is my local area, this is the area where I grew up. And I knew a lot of the old people that used to live here. Sadly, they're all dead now, of course. But yeah, you'll hear all about that in this video. Behind me is the memorial hall. That was gifted to the village by the Barrington family. They were a very rich, wealthy family, probably in the Victorian, Victorian period, perhaps early to mid-Victorian period. Let's find a nice seat to sit on where I can gather my thoughts. I've also got the bike parked by the bench. I'll show you the apocalypse bike. I've finally got a rack fitted onto it. Panniers, courtesy of Steve. Thanks, Steve. As you can see, I got absolutely masses of room. No chance of ever my heel striking against the panniers. What else have I done to it? Oh, mud guards. I fitted mud guards on the front. I'm running 32-35 psi tyre pressures when I'm on the road, and it rolls quite nice, quite fast. But off road, I've had it down to about 15 psi for the balloonage and suspension sort of thing, because there's no suspension built into the bike, so you rely on the tyres for that. So I was hoping this is going to be a real practical mule for me in the upcoming adventures I've got planned for bike packing. On one boot zipper from Planet X, if you're interested. And it's a 1x chain set, meaning it's just got one gear at the front and a good big ratio at the back. And I've got 3 bottle cages. I wrap the camping mat around here. That just means I can lean the bike against stuff. It's not going to scratch this frame. It's all steel bicycle. And when I go camping, I've got an extra layer to put on the ground. I carry my spare tool kit bits and pieces in there, and then on this side here I've not got it on at the moment, but I have that reserved for me my stove. So back to my comment that I left Neil Oliver. Brilliant channel Neil's got, I think, and he's really a force for good. Now personally I believe that there are too many vehicles on the road in certain places and at certain times of the day, and I've witnessed it myself, the congestion, traffic jams, it's just horrendous in some places, especially in the built up areas. But so yeah, it'd be nice to see fewer vehicles perhaps. Maybe some of you that don't agree, but you're free to leave your comments underneath this video if you want. I also believe that the world is a globe and that we landed on the moon, and you're free to leave comments as well if you want beneath the video. But please don't expect me to engage in an argument with you, because I'm not interested in that. That's just my personal beliefs. What you believe is up to you, and you're as much entitled to that belief as I am to mine. Anyway, Neil's video was about the 15-minute cities and the way that our lifestyles have been eroded, and the way that humanity's gone in the last sort of number of years. And my comment went something like this. In the early part of the last century, that's the 20th century, there were a small number of village people who were very elderly and who, I was told, hardly ever ventured beyond the parish boundary. That's absolutely true. There were a number of people that just lived their lives out and they didn't go outside this parish or very infrequently. Maybe once or twice a year they either walked or cycled 7 miles to the nearest town of Swindon, which is now where I live. You know, they lived in a 15-minute village, if you like, because everything was within 15 minutes of where they were from. So what did they have? They had fresh eggs and produce on the allotment or the back garden, because in the villages all the houses had large gardens, good-sized gardens, and all were carefully tilled and tended, and with pride. Some kept chickens, and the odd garden even had a sty for a pig. And that's also very true. My uncle, my aunt, they had a pig in a small sty in a back of a cottage garden, literally about 300 yards from here. It was just as important back then to grow veg as it was to go to work. And we had half our garden was given over to vegetables, and everybody else's, you know, you had a patch of lawn, and at the bottom of the garden you had a good sized vegetable patch, enough to provide you most of your year's food. The garden put food on the table, good wholesome food. A solid steel frame bicycle was used for transport. They had all steel bikes back then. Incidentally, my on one boot zip is also an all steel bicycle. And they'd get on their bikes and they'd cycle down to the high street where there was a thrift shop. Well, more about that in a minute. They'd cycle across to the villages, go and see their friends, and perhaps down the pub. You know, they'd do all those sort of things. Now, down in the village high street, we'll take a look at that in a minute, there was a thrift shop which sold clothes and shoes. There was a hardware shop that sold seeds and paraffin, garden tools, etc. In fact, you could get almost anything there, even a glass of sherry. I remember it, you used to go through the door and there was a little cask in front of you, and you could buy a small quantity of sherry. Or delicious sliced ham. They had a ham slicer there. And the village had 4 pubs. It had a newsagent's and a tobacconist's. It had a men's club. It had a butcher's shop, a fish and chip shop, a corner shop, a co-op, a greengrocer's. It had 3 garages and a blacksmith's shop. Also, I forgot to mention, it also had a bank. And something else, it had a florist's, and it also had 2 churches, one Methodist and the other was Anglican. If anything heavy or awkward needed to be transported, the old people, they had a wheelbarrow, and whatever And what they never had, they never missed. Yes, a type of 15-minute city, I suppose, but in a good way. The thing is, you see, we've got used to so much in our lives now that we haven't got good things to look forward to like the old people had. You know, they had all this to come. Things were improving, and now things really can't improve much more, I don't think. And that's the sad fact of it. This is the new 15-minute city, you know. The new 15-minute city, it will be horrendous. Not at all like the old one just described. And the food will be little better than plastic. And you'll have to eat it, because the postage stamp garden, probably cheek by jowl with the neighbours and in constant shadow, will struggle to grow anything to sustain good health. And the poor people who live in such places won't even have a chimney or fireplace, and they'll be paying through the nose for the pleasure of living in such a place. In all probability, they won't own their home, they'll be renting, and they won't be happy. That's the case for many people. Many people, many young people now are in that situation. It's been insidious, this decline of humanity. The wealth and quality of life has been transferred away from the many, and all they have left is bare sustenance, and for some, that only with the help of a food bank. But they got night trainers and a smartphone, so they ain't doing too bad. Tongue in cheek there. How much more people can take before they push people over the edge? I count myself fortunate because I was brought up in a village, actually this one, this village here. I say like the one described, but it was this village earlier, and I learned some of the old ways. I always used to mix with people older than myself. I have very few friends my own age, but one or two friends my own age. Rest of my friends, I found it easier to get on with older people. I also am fortunate. I've got a good sized garden at home. I've got a wood burning stove. I've got a fireplace and a chimney. I've only ever been on the plane 3 or 4 times in my life, and to be quite honest, it wouldn't bother me too much if I never went abroad again. I'm fairly content and fairly fortunate, but it's the younger generation that I feel sad for. They don't have a strong connection to the old ways anymore, thanks to technology and the way things have gone. So I think the key to a better quality of life is looking back into the past, looking to the old ways. And so I thought on this video I would take you for a journey through this village and show you what's happened to it, where these old places were, the old shops, etc., what's become of them, and the infrastructure it had back then. And back then it only had a population of maybe, looking at families, maybe it had sort of 200, 300, 400 families living here, and it had all those amenities just for those numbers of people, you know. We didn't want for anything really as a child, and I remember all we had for heating were open fireplaces, and we had single glazed windows, and they used to freeze up on the inside in the winter time. And you know, I can't ever remember my mum and dad ever complaining. We certainly didn't complain as children. We had a great time, a great childhood. I was so fortunate, and I feel so sad really for young people these days, that kids and children that are growing up now, they've got lots that we didn't have, but they've got things, but we had things that they can't have, and that's sort of sad really in a way. Anyway, yeah, let's take a look at the village. Thanks for the seat, Brian. Well, in my comment I mentioned the Methodist church. Well, there it is. Right, down in the high street, there's the florists. Next to it, this used to be the bank. There. Opened my first bank account in there. It's in the house now. Next to the bank, We have the co-op. Co-op shop. Next to the co-op. It's called a farm shop now, but that used to be a little hardware shop. And a hairdresser's. I forgot to put that in my comment. We had a hairdresser's. Looking across the road. Where it says the Golshan. That's now an Indian restaurant. That used to be a fish and chip shop. Sorry, no. That used to be the blacksmith shop. Next to it was a fish and chip shop. And also there was a little haberdashery shop over there as well. Something else I forgot to mention in my little comment was it's also had a pharmacy. That's been there for years. This now is property management letting agency, but that used to be the butcher's shop. Mr. Hurst used to run the butcher's shop. A bit further on and panning across the way there, that used to be the tobacconist's news agents. Oh look, we've got this as well. Another hairdresser's. And a post office. Oh, other things, it's all coming back now, look, now I'm here. Over there. That used to be one of the garages. And there were three garages, the Hut Garage, Swan Hill Garage and that garage. Both Swan Hill Garage and the Hut Garage now are gone. Oh, and it's even got a school. Another thing I forgot to put in my comment, the fact that it's also got a doctor's, proper village doctor as well. The doctor lived, he lived in this grand house here, Elm Tree House. Dr. Crockett, that was. Dr. Demune, when I was living here, Dr. Demune used to live there. And in front of me, where it says Blossom Barn, that was another little corner shop, the bus stop shop. And if you were naughty, you got put in the stocks. Well, you saw the Methodist church. Now we'll look at the Anglican church. This is where my dear dad is laid to rest. So there you go, there's St Andrew's. We're taking a shortcut now to the other end of the village, then we'll work back up to the high street again and look at the amenities on the other side. Do you remember in my reading earlier, I mentioned about my uncle and aunt had a pig and they lived in some cottages. Well, these are the cottages. And my lovely old nan lived in one of these. I think she lived in that one, number 14, just down there. Even in her old age, living in that cottage, most of her garden was dug up and given over to growing vegetables. And in her old age, there was no flushing toilet in that cottage. My mum used to have to go down and dig a hole in the garden to bury the waste. All I can say is the ground was very fertile and it grew some lovely vegetables. Anyway, we're coming into the village from the other end now. I'm coming up on the left, the white building just in front of me, that used to be the pub. No, it still is a pub. I thought I'd finished it. Yes, the Crown, always been the Crown. That was the Crown pub. The thatched building, just here. It's now called the Treatment Rooms. But that used to be the thatched shop. hardware shop where you could get all the bits and pieces and paraphernalia you might need. And next to it, that was the men's club. Apparently, my grandfather, who passed away in 1959, used to go there a lot and used to play snooker in there. Now the full-size snooker table. Going back before my time, the post office has always been where it's been, up there where I showed you earlier. But this is where it used to be, the old post office. Anyway, let's make our way back up the high street. Across the way over there, another pub, the Prince of Wales. And no sooner have we passed the Prince of Wales than we've got another pub on our left called the Barrington Arms. But over there, where it says Chinese Treasure Takeaway, that used to be a greengrocer's. So hopefully you can see, even today, there's still a lot of amenities in Swindon, in that small village. Obviously the population now has expanded somewhat, but back then, even, you know, 50, 80, 100 years ago, it had most of that infrastructure, most of those amenities there. And you can see why I thought that was very much like a 15-minute village, and why some of the old people never even had to leave the parish, and they didn't, many of them didn't, and they didn't have a lot, they didn't need a lot, and they didn't want a lot. Life was simpler, really, but in a good way. I'm outside the village by about half a mile now, and the building over on the right, that used to be a pub as well. That was the last pub, the fourth pub. It's not a pub no longer. I'm up on the old chalk track now, which is the Ridgeway, the place I come to often when I need to clear my head, which these days is quite a lot. But I think what I'm trying to put across really is how more self-reliant people were back in the day. You know, years and years ago, they would cater for their own needs. They didn't rely upon corporations and massive supermarkets, etc. They just got on with it. I've got to concentrate because I'm on a slippery track. So quite how that translates to the situation of modern people, I'm not quite sure. I think, I suppose really in a way it's sort of pepper mindset, I suppose. I'm not a pepper, although I've got 2 or 3 months stores of food at home, and I've got a garden, I've got a greenhouse, and I've got a wood burning stove. So I've got alternatives, but there's many that haven't, and you've got to feel sorry for those people if the situation does get much worse. I don't like how the powers that be, the world's evil forum and such like, have put themselves into positions of authority when they weren't elected by anybody, and they just seem to have that opinion that their views are right and everybody else has got to listen to them, I don't think that's right at all. So I'm just going to do what I'm going to do. Regarding motor vehicles, emissions from motor vehicles have never been so clean as they are today. I believe EVs, probably with the way they are at the moment, aren't the way forward. There's not enough resources, the power grid can't cope with the extra demand, and the technology in the batteries isn't there to allow them to become as what's the word for it, as practical as an internal combustion engine. And they're creating just as much pollution, only the pollution is offset. The power's got to be generated to charge them up. The element, the rare earth elements have got to be dug out of the ground. It's hypocrisy, as far as I can see. I ride the bicycle simply because I enjoy it. I enjoy the free transport it gives me. I enjoy the exercise. I enjoy getting to places like this, off the beaten track, where I can be left alone to my thoughts. And I'm quite content in my own little way. I got my two motorbikes. I've also got a car. The car's off the road. It needs an MOT. Last year I rode 1,000 miles in my car. Everything else I did on push bikes and motorcycles. And I think going forward, that's how it's going to be for me. I probably won't bother putting the car back on the road. I'm just going to rely on bicycles and motorcycles. Oh well, what a lovely bike ride. Really enjoyed this. Anyway, I've probably opened a can of worms. You've got to bear in mind that I'm just a layman. I'm not a scientist, I'm not in full... I don't have the full facts about what's going on, really, you know. I'm only going on my feelings and what I'm hearing others say and how they feel. And I think it's good to be, what's the word, sceptical about a lot of things. Sceptical. So that doesn't mean to say, I've got to say this because some people take it the wrong way. It doesn't mean to say that you don't believe a certain thing. It just means that you want more. You want to hear more evidence about a certain thing before you properly make your mind up. But I'm sceptical about a lot of things in life and open-minded, and I think that's about all you can do really in the current state of play of the world. I've got no answers, I'm afraid. Just try and be happy, try and be content, and get out on your bike if you can. It's great, it's really good fun and good exercise, and you get the fresh air, and there's not a lot of cars.